Chesterfield Township is one of Michigan's great suburbs. The township features clean, well-kept neighborhoods, outstanding schools, exceptional parks and city services, and many shopping options. The township's appeal has supporting numbers as well, as its population rose by over 15% between the 2000 and 2010 census. While Chesterfield Township is now renowned for its modern neighborhoods, 50 years ago, the township was very different. Back then, the township was known for its wide-open spaces and fertile soil. See, back then, Chesterfield Township was a farming community of about 7,000 people.
But most of those people were concentrated in the area east side of Chesterfield Township, which is about 27 square miles of land space, a little bit out in the water, but that's about what it is. And most of those people lived in the area between Jefferson and the water, because many, many years before that, there were cottages there. People living in Detroit and in the big city areas used to come out here to the area, build their cottages, and enjoy their summertime and their warm winter months on their cottages. But in 1964, or before that time, homes were starting to be developed. As people were coming out here, they were making it their full-time, year-round residence. So again, most of that was along the water area. And of course, some areas a little bit east of Gratiot. As far as businesses are concerned, there were a few along Jefferson, quite a few along 23 Mile Road, as the roads extended out into New Baltimore, Algonac area, and of course some along Gratiot, which of course was the main thoroughfare.
The peaceful neighborhood of Chesterfield Township was little known outside its borders, but that changed on May 8, 1964. On that fateful day, a weather phenomenon tore through Chesterfield Township, and the force of the storm rolling in is something the survivors will never forget.
And we suddenly looked up and we saw this black cloud literally rolling at us sideways. It was not a funnel. If it was a funnel, it was literally laying on its side. And just this front rolling in at us very quickly.
I said, "Boy, that's really black sky, Mom." And then she just slammed the window shut and she said, "Get under the bed, get under the bed." Because we were living in my grandmother's cottage. So we had nowhere to go, but she must have known what it was. And so she just shoved us all under the bed.
Just the screaming loud pitch noise that I just covered my ears. They hurt. And when I looked at the big picture window, it was just black. You couldn't see anything. And then a loud explosion as all the windows of the whole house just exploded.
We were looking and she said, "Oh, look how black the sky is over there. We're going to have a tornado." And I said, "No, because when you look over by Selfridge, the sun was shining and the jet was going in." So I said, "We're not going to have a tornado." So we turn around and walk out of that room, just getting by the kitchen table, and the windows blew in. And
we're all kind of freaking out because we're just looking outside and it's just pouring like crazy. And then, I don't know, all hell must have broke loose. I don't remember windows breaking or anything, but I remembered we all got down on the floor.
We saw it get dark and cloudy, and Mrs. Sarnes came out and gathered us little kids out and said, "Tornado, we could see it coming in the wind." And we all raced back into the barn and we could see it coming right towards us.
"My God, go upstairs, get the baby, there's a train coming through the house." He said, "Barbara, shut up." I said, "No." And he looked at me, he said, "Oh my God, that's a tornado."
Like many others, the Westfall home stood in the direct path of the tornado. Moments before impact, Marie Westfall did everything she could to keep her family safe.
I got all the kids in the hallway, and it took us right along. I can remember, it was like a giant hand your head. The pressure was so deep. The whole house went out, and there was a great big, like a V-shaped plowed spot where the house drug out, and it exploded and dropped us out over on the next street.
William Balfour was a deputy with the Macomb County Sheriff's Department. When the tornado hit, he was off duty, but he heard the sirens and took action.
And I was going home on Bay Street, and when I got home, I heard the whistles blowing and that. And I never, as a rule, would follow a fire truck, but my wife and my three-year-old son got in the truck with me, and I took off, and I followed the truck. It was a New Baltimore fire truck. I followed it out Jefferson, and I could already see damage right on what they call Crapo Creek in New Baltimore, where Brad's barbecue is. There was a grocery store there, and the wall was out. A cement block, as we approached Lottie View, I seen the Baltimore fire truck pull down Lottie View, and I looked over there and it looked like a war zone. And I continued on towards Snyder Road. When I got to Snyder Road, this guy come running up to me with two children in his hand, bleeding like the devil. And I put him in my truck and I headed for the hospital.
Like most disasters, rescue efforts were almost impossible at first. With most roads blocked, automobiles were stuck, and nobody could get in or out by car.
Thinking, my gosh, we heard sirens all over. They were just coming. It seemed like the air was just full of them. And we kept saying, where's everybody? You know, we need help here. We need help. And, of course, not realizing there was trees and Edison posts and everything, you know, across the road. So no vehicle could even come in till they kind of cleared that away.
The family kind of regrouped, and my brother Jim and my dad got to the house, and my dad kind of tried to huddle everybody into the family car to leave, and it was like, my mom said, where are we going? And my dad kind of balked, and he says, well, we got to get out of here. And my mom said, well, look, there's electric wires across the road. Even if we can get out of the driveway, where are we going to go?
You couldn't get through Chesterfield Township with an ambulance because there's all the trees, the telephone poles, all the roads were covered up. So there's no way any our hospitals you could get through. So the horses with the sheriff's posse, which I rode with them with my dad and all other sheriff's deputies, that were in the sheriff's posse, and we actually hauled people that were all mangled, thrown all over the place, broken legs, arms, dead, some dead. We hauled them down to, made a gurney out of fence post with a blanket and put them behind the horse, and then took some of them, most of them to 21 and Cotton Road so they could find an ambulance and then go from there to the hospitals.
The hospitals quickly filled up with trauma patients, and the numbers of the injured rose steadily throughout the recovery. As area hospitals filled, Selfridge Air National Guard Base took the overflow of patients.
There was one airman out there that he was credited with taking over 40 people to the hospital. They were using the base hospital at the time, as well as the hospitals in Mount Clemens. And every time you'd turn around, put people in the back of the station wagon, it seemed like he was just gone for a short time, and here he is waiting for some more.
People from all over came together to help the victims of the tornado.
There was all these people that you didn't know that came and, you know, donated stuff and money and different things to the families that were in the tornado. Yeah, everybody helped out with that.
Disaster relief agencies like the Red Cross became a rock in the distressed community.
So they set up an emergency clothing and stuff like that there for people in the township to come and anybody that needed anything. The Red Cross was there right away and Salvation Army.
They opened a center at, I think it was that Green School, for anybody who needed some clothes or something, you know, like that there. And of course, I had my clothes out on the clothesline, but they weren't there no more. They helped us out that way.
The tornado was devastating to the area, but it's the loss that came with the destruction that made the event so memorable, even 50 years after it first touched down.
One thing that really stuck out in my mind, I was in the first grade, and one of the victims, Susan Westfall, she was our room monitor that day. And she would go around and take papers for the teacher. And I remember her holding the drinking fountain on so that all the kids could get a drink that day. And she had passed, you know, then she was killed in that tornado that night, you know, so.
For all the loss and devastation caused by the tornado, many of those involved couldn't help but feel lucky. Lucky to have what they had left and lucky to be alive for another day.
There was a telephone pole with a transformer, those big huge transformers on it, that had fallen like right next to the bed. And they said we were lucky because if it would have fallen on the bed, we'd have all been dead. So we were like, I don't know, for some reason we're still here.
But I just thank God that even though there were deaths, and I feel bad about that, I'm just, after looking at the pictures, that it was back then and not now, because look at the growth that Chesterfield has had.
You know, if it happened now, oh my.
My mother and father's bedroom door slammed shut, ripped off its hinges, and flew over my head about this high and went right through the wall where I had been standing. So I would have been dead had I not been, got, get down, you know, kind of a thing.
My kids were all safe and everything. Some of our friends didn't make it.
And it's like, I even to this day, I'll think about that and think, wow, we were very lucky.
Yeah. Michigan isn't known for having major tornadoes. In fact, many times the tornado comes and goes without causing much damage at all. That wasn't the case back in May 1964. The tornado that caused so much damage in Chesterfield was a true force of nature that was as wide as three football fields end to end.
For a short period of time, this was a wide tornado about a half mile wide, which is a very wide tornado in any part of the country. And it was incredibly strong. It was rated an F4 on the Fujita scale, and the Fujita scale goes from 0 to 5. We get very, very few 4s or 5s in Michigan. I mean a handful of such storms in the last 30 years. So it was unusually strong. Estimated wind speed in the Anchor Bay Chesterfield tornado was over 200 miles per hour. That's an incredibly destructive amount of power. And although it was not on the ground at that strength for very long, when it was, it did tremendous damage, and unfortunately it hit very populated areas.
With advances in radar imaging, meteorologists now have the tools to give area residents more time to prepare for life-threatening weather. But when it comes to the path of a tornado, even today, predictions are impossible.
Something will disrupt the circulation right near the surface. It might be some other winds around the storm itself. It might be some buildings and trees. It could be anything that just at least momentarily disrupts that. So that's where we get what seems like such a weird and hard to understand skipping, where it will demolish one house and skip over the next one and barely take a shingle off.
The tornado that hit Chesterfield Township in May 1964 is still remembered by those who lived through it, and its massive scale and devastating effects are still being studied by meteorologists today. But while that fateful day scarred the land and the township's residents, the power of the human spirit and a lot of hard work helped make Chesterfield Township into the great place it is today.
Where you were when Kennedy got assassinated? Well, I know where I was. I was in junior high school. But I also know where it was in the tornado in 1964 in Anchor Bay. Because it was, to me, that was as big as the Kennedy assassination because I was there.
What I remember the worst part about it all was when you didn't find your family pet, when you didn't find some of the things that were personal, that really were important to you. It's an experience that when you see it and you're unfamiliar with it except for the photographs that you see on television, the videos or whatever, you can't feel that. You have to be there to sense. And it's a very gruesome and awesome feeling of complete silence. There are no animals, there are no birds, there's nothing. And all that you see is things shaking in the wind, pieces of paper blowing around, and people's personal belongings that are now not personal anymore. They belong to everybody.